That was free.
Okay. Okay.
Hey, Pam, how are you?
Yeah, it's all of us. We're gonna start the meeting, in a second, John. Just hold on.
Okay. Call the meeting order, Kim.
Greenwich Township Committee. March 16, 2017. Adequate notice of this meeting was given in accordance with the Open Public Meeting Act by mailing the schedule of the Township Committee to the Express Times and North Star Ledger newspaper, posting the copy on the Township bulletin board, and filing a copy with the Township clerk. Roll call. Kenya?
Here.
Dean?
Here.
Spencer?
Here.
Marqueta?
Here.
Marson?
Here.
Rise for the flag salute.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, we're gonna need a motion to go into, executive session to take a call from, one of our land use attorneys.
I'll make that motion.
Do you wanna make a comment?
Regarding, is this, the call litigation?
Yes.
Regarding, litigation matter, which should...
I'll second that. Thank you.
Frank made the motion and I'll second.
Yep. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. We're gonna have to ask you to step down the hallway for a few minutes. Thanks. Okay. Motion to come out of executive session. Someone wanna make it?
Right now, it's 7.
Motion.
Second.
Will, Frank, second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, we merge executive session. We're up to 7:27 PM. We discussed one matter which was pending litigation, which was the pending toll litigation, and also its, impact on the school district. No response was taken. Copy of these minutes will be available at such time as the committee determines there is no harm to the public.
Okay. Okay, this, we're gonna, I need a motion to open a public comment.
Make that motion.
Second.
Aye. At this time, anybody, a member of the public would like to come up to the podium, state your name and address, and make your comments to us, feel free.
Hi, this is Debbie Walteray, and I'm with the Greenwich Township PTO, and she's in her spring 5K committee, and she's not here to officially inform you. We pick a date for this in her spring 5K, and if there are any questions you may have.
What's the date?
The date is June 11th.
Okay.
Sunday morning. The, course is the same as it has been for the past 7 years now. We are going to do a color run like we've done for the past 3. Everything essentially remains the same as it has.
Okay.
And the police are aware?
Yeah.
Yes.
You've been working?
She covered, he has the date.
Okay. We're all good. Anything specific you need from us that we need to do?
No. Just the cooperation with the police department.
Okay.
Thank you.
I think we'll be able to get that for you, okay?
Okay.
Thanks a lot for coming.
Thank you.
Anyone else? We don't usually respond to questions. You can ask the questions, and after we close the public comment, then we're, if someone up here would like to, they'll give you a response. It's not a question and answer period.
Public comment period.
It's public comment.
question or comment is, I should say, that I understand that there's $60,000 that's been set aside for these police officers who are working without a contract. And I'm concerned about the retro pay, and if in fact that $60,000 is going to cover all of which is owed for the retro pay, including vacation time, sick time, benefits, and all that would be included in their contract. And where is the $60,000 coming from? From what fund? And how do we know that it's $60,000? The other thing that has come to my attention is that the revenue in this town, in terms of ticketing, is $45,000 compared to the last 2 years, which was $150,000. That's a great concern to me. It should be for the rest of the citizens in this town as to why that's occurred. So I realize this is just a comment and not a question, but these are questions that I'm certainly going to be over and more information about.
Sure.
I'm concerned about this. As a taxpayer, I'm paying over $16,000 in taxes. The last thing I want to bring to your attention is $95,000 was, in my opinion, misspent for the years of litigation for Chief Hummer for reasons that we all know happened. I think it was a reckless decision on the part of the governing body to have entertained and gotten into that contentious litigation. But my comment is, why did it last so long? And why did the cost skyrocket to the point that it did? The attorney and also the trained mediator for the EEOC, why wasn't that somehow, who and why did someone spend the time and stop that cost? That is a very high cost of litigation that now comes off of the taxpayer's back. So, these are my comments, and I think you may all know that I've been very busy doing opioid classes and many other issues, but I will read these issues tonight, and I will be back again, as well to see some of the information that I've been. But I would like to, this period is not open for answers, I would like to meet with each one of the individuals that is speaking about the questions that I've raised tonight.
Okay. Thank you. Anyone else wish to make any public comments? You have to come up to the podium, sir.
Okay.
State your name and address then.
Okay. My name is Henry Rewerts. Just wanted to speak for a moment about the situation with the railroad cars here. We've been doing this to the council for some time now. We appreciate all your efforts. Maybe they'll get approved, I don't know. From what I'm hearing, some of the other elected officials in the state are expressing their discussion of the railroad trains parked to their peers and others. So maybe pushing helps. I don't know yet. But I just wanted to bring something to your attention that happened a couple of weeks ago. Walking around my property a little bit in the afternoon, about 5 o'clock or 4 o'clock or something like this, I saw a couple of individuals up by the railroad cars. Both had reflective vests on, so I thought, oh, good, because the parked cars are moving, they're checked and inspected. That wasn't the case, they were there in spray paint, perfect. Called the police, and I'm not sure what happened after that, but anyhow, we're left with the result now of a situation where the railroad has advised the town police that they have no concern about the cars whatsoever. don't care about the condition or things that can handle us. And the town police told me that if that's the case, they're not going to get involved in poisoning those railroad cars either. So what do we have? We have a situation where there's some property in the town that is unpoliced. It's like the property that attracts people from out of the area. Two people that were there, they're not from the area. One told me he was from central New Jersey, the other one told me he was from New Orleans. I think that's a very unhealthy mix of circumstances there. The people from out of the area wandering around unopposed, not going to be stopped by the police. But what is that, what happens next? In my opinion, and I think it's been proved time and time again, if you let small crimes go unopposed, they become larger crimes. It just mushrooms. And I think the police agree with me with that, too. I think he's going to call me. That was wrong. But I just want to bring that to your attention, because I think it needs to be straightened out quickly. Because road closures quickly around the area where people learn they can go, commit crimes, and no one cares, no one's going to stop them. I think that the council should discuss this with the police department. See what can be done. It shouldn't go unpoliced, either by the town or by the railroad. One of the two has to do something about that.
Okay.
Thank you. No comments?
Well, right now?
Anything? I mean, is that what I'm hearing?
We need to discuss that. There's a lot more to your problem than meets the eye.
Okay.
But yes, we will have a conversation on it.
Thank you.
Anybody else want to make any comments? Seeing none, motion to close public comment.
So moved. Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
The litigation with the police department, Chief Hummer, I agree with you 1,000%. It has never happened. It was absolutely absurd and was wrong. Speaking for myself, I'll speak for everybody. Not one of us was on council when that happened. We did not authorize the payment of any of those bills. We were as aghast about the price and the cost of those bills as you are, and you hit it right at the nail on the head. We agree with I at least agree with you 1,000% that it was wrong. We had the chief back within 8 months of when I got on and when these other three gentlemen got on. Paul just got on this year. So I think with all of your issues there, we agree with you 1,000% that was totally inappropriate. That's why he's back. That's why we worked so hard to bring him back. And if you had been here earlier in the year, you would have heard us all complaining about the cost of that litigation. So we agree with you 1,000% on that.
The ticket revenue,
We feel was probably partially down because of the morale of the department during that process. Again, none of us were on the governing body when that happened. I just spoke with the mayor of Pahakon in the last week. He said revenues are coming up. They're getting better. Part of that revenue issue also was from the state police with weigh station, where apparently under the previous president, some of the statutes and laws that they wanted to enforce, which would have brought in more revenue, they were basically told not to, if you want to address that better.
All right. When the weigh station first opened up, we were getting, came up, 2 feet high of tickets, you know. We're getting 700 a month. We got 600 a year last year. That's for a whole year. Their investigations or their inspections, I should say, it's inspection, not investigation, are mainly on full inspections of the trucks. So that's where the emphasis is. Right, Chief? I think that's what we got out of that meeting. We had five top brass from the state police meeting with us because we were concerned about where did all the revenue go. And basically, they're doing more inspections, which... The way I understood it was that they don't issue a ticket, that they issue them a full report on what they find, and that gets turned into their insurance company and the various trucking companies, the way they, you know, like our automobile, we get charged if we have an accident. Well, they get charged on their liability to the type of vehicles that we put on the road. So that's where that emphasis is right now. Unfortunately, I would love to see 700 tickets a month being generated out of that. Weigh station.
It wasn't federal DOT too was telling him not to enforce certain rules and laws too? Didn't say it was.
No, I don't think it was that. Okay. She put the.
They were we're focusing your attention more, I believe, on safety, and those violations don't bring in as much money as their original tickets that they were focusing on. So.
I was just going to say, my recollection, they were saying that they wanted compliance, so they wanted the roads to be safe and the trucks to be safe.
Right.
They said, even though in the past they had generated a lot of ticket revenue for Greenwich, they said that, you know, $100 ticket to, I don't want to mention a trucking company, to a big trucking company, they'd rather pay the $100. But when you send this report in saying the deficiency they had to the insurance company, that costs them real dollars, and that's what, in effect, makes the road safer. So, as Committee Mechanic said, that was kind of the focus of safety and making sure that these trucks are operating safely on the road. So, while the ticket revenue is down, they felt that by doing these inspections that they had to report to the carrier their deficiencies, that they're getting safer vehicles on the road, which makes it safer. Justification.
And I think your last question was the police contract. Again, that was started in previous years. None of us were on council at that time. We've only been on for the last year, and we would expect that that will be completed in maybe the next meeting.
I think also on the revenue with the tickets, I mean, our manpower, we were down to, what, 8 guys? At one point, 8 guys. So,
it's hard to one of them was doing secretarial work.
Exactly.
So, we're down to 7 guys.
Right. So,
yeah, that's why we don't do it. Otherwise, we'll be here at 11 o'clock, you and I have a discussion.
Okay.
Yeah, we're all reachable. You know, there's emails and things like that. We're all phone numbers, so please feel free to reach out.
Okay. Approval of the February 16th minutes.
Need a motion.
Got a motion. Anybody want a second?
Second it.
Discussion? Anybody have any corrections, the others, notes, messages, anything about it? Seeing none? Roll call.
Yes.
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 Yes. Payment of bills. We have to take it.
Well, hold on. We got to get a motion.
Motion to pay bills. Anybody make a motion?
I'll make the motion for $1,092,480.60. But I do have questions.
We have a second.
Second it.
Okay. Discussion.
Firehouse minor subdivision. We have a bill for $1,106.25. Who's paying for that? Does the firehouse pay for that? Fire department? Or do we pay for it?
I questioned that myself. I asked Mike Finelli, and he said that was, he also responded, that's a good question. He assumed that the township would be paying for that. So I guess I'm putting that out to you. Is that what we're doing going forward?
So I'll refer to our attorney. I believe it's property that we leased to Joe, to the fire department. So, I mean, can we make that?
Well, we're in the process of subdividing it to give it to him, to turn it over to him, and in a few years to build the department on it. So
this is part of that work?
This was work that Mike Finelli had to do in order to subdivide that off the main piece of the project.
Okay, then I would think it's our responsibility, but that's my opinion.
Mark, do you have some questions?
Yeah. Kathleen, the computer update, is that also a monthly bill besides?
That's true.
Okay. Was it?
Computer update.
All right. Or was it, yeah, all right. Is that a monthly bill that they?
How much is it, the 1,000?
No, 365. Yeah, that's why I thought it was website, not, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
That's good. No,
it's the
code.
It's the domain hosting. I forget the vendor.
And is that a monthly number?
Annual,
okay. Yeah. Well, because I also saw a 409 maintenance number, which was an annual number. I should have earmarked these pages, sorry.
Any vendor names?
Well, I'm looking, I can go on to the next one too here, in which Joe, I guess, could answer that best. Joe, I see $47,445 and change on a 2000 Pierce fire truck?
Depends on the air of the truck. Annual pay.
Okay. And that, we, that, you just bought that one a couple years ago, right?
Yes, it was used, I think that was for only five years.
All right, so that was our number for the five-year term on it?
Year.
And then, all right, and when is that paid off?
2 more years.
2 more years, so that'll be 2019, and then in theory, 2020, that truck's so-so in the way of the fire rules?
20 years old.
Right, okay.
Just getting back to, you recognize LCR?
LCR is the website domain, that's yearly.
So Cindy Kerrigan simply updates.
And Cindy Kerrigan updates his website for $365, that's a monthly charge.
And that's a monthly charge, she does it every month?
But it's not always $365, it depends on what, like, things the sender.
Okay, all right, that's all. And then the last thing would be for the attorney, litigation Fleming. Oh, he just stepped out of the room, I didn't see that.
What page, John? Nine.
Page nine.
That's GRC, Government Records Council, denial of access of records.
Right, I understand. And that particular fee occurred for just this month? Because I've seen small ones. Now all of a sudden there's something big that's cropped up?
For Mike's review of the case.
Yeah. Okay. I'm good.
I have a, this is not a big bill, but the postage meter, do you, yeah, I don't know, was it $300 or something, but do you break out, like, what the sewer versus the tax department?
So here's, I just started doing this on this bill's list. You're going to see what's called reserve account.
What page?
That is page 12. Historically, what they've done here in Greenwich is when they needed postage, they would go in, basically just use it, and then it would get billed by quickly goes, and they would add on finance charges. We're basically borrowing their money before we actually pay it. There's this thing called reserve account, where you can put money in monthly, by month, whatever you want to do to kind of put it away, so that I can better coordinate with the departments. Okay, $200 for admin, $300 for sewer. That way, and I'm going to show you how to do this. When you go in, it's going to say available funds, and you just select from that. So we'll have more control over it, and you won't be incurring those interest charges.
Okay.
You can, if you want, with even more control, you can set up that machine to say, this is sewer, this is a sewer bill. So you can track it really super detailed if you wanted to.
You can put in like a code for each department that they have to hit?
As soon as I go to use it, you push in what department, so then it scans, and then at the end of the month, you can run a report off of each one of the departments that are in total.
So now, with that, me putting that money kind of in the bank, so to speak, you can code it however you want it.
Right.
We'll go over it.
Yeah.
Okay, and you spoke about that open space project, $500.
I think that was just for a meeting.
Yeah.
Not necessarily from a sewer park, but an open space meeting.
Okay. And the other thing I do, Frank, did you get my CC on the letter that I sent to Pinelli today?
Yeah.
And he responded?
Yep.
So I'm hoping that at our next open space meeting, we can get a definitive number as what the engineering cost is going to be for phase two. So, and then we can go from there, on out.
Roll call?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, with the exception of mine.
Yes.
Yes. The resolutions, I need a motion to vote for a resolution authorizing redemption of tax liens. That's resolution 2017-41 with the list of property holders down on the bottom, lien holders. And can we do them both together? 2017-42, authorizing the refund of tax overpayments to the tax owner is listed on the bottom of that.
Make a motion.
Oh, you make a motion?
Second.
A second. Discussion. Roll call.
Henya?
Yes.
Dean?
Yes.
Spencer?
Yes.
Marqueta?
Yes.
Okay, next is resolution 2017-43, authorizing the chief financial officer to be appointed as a qualified purchasing agent for the township. And that would be Kathleen.
We have to do the ordinance first, Mayor.
Okay.
No?
Okay.
What page is the ordinance?
That's 2017-01? Okay. Okay, so we're just gonna do, I need a motion to accept ordinance. 2017-01, creating the position of purchasing agent, as established in chapter 44, article 10, sections 46 to 52.
Is it second reading?
Second reading.
Okay.
So, I need a motion for the second reading.
So we need a motion now for open public comment? Then I'll make the motion for public comment on resolution, I mean ordinance 2017-01.
A second.
All favor?
Aye. Anyone wishing to make a statement regarding this ordinance?
Mike, can you just explain to the audience, you know, in case they weren't here last month, what the advantages of having, creating this position?
Yeah, basically the main advantage is that you've got a person that's been trained and certified and qualified purchasing agent, and what it allows you to do is it raises the threshold $40,000. So right now, any contract over 17.5 has to be bid, so this raises it to 40 as long as you have a qualified purchasing agent. And by the way, just because you have a qualified purchasing agent doesn't mean you have to do it. If you had a contract that was, you thought was going to be around $20,000, you're still free to put that out to bid. It just gives you the ability to do that. So.
I'll make the motion to close public comment, seeing that nobody ran to the podium.
Second.
Aye.
So now we need a motion to pass the ordinance. Okay, so we need a motion. Ordinance 2017-02.
Need a motion.
We have a second. A second. Discussion. Anybody have any questions, discussions here? Roll call.
Yes.
Yes.
Spencer? Yes.
Marqueta?
Yes.
Now we're going to do the resolution and making the appointment. Right. Okay. Need a motion for resolution 2017-43, creating the position of qualified purchasing agent and appointing the CFO, Kathleen Rinalda, into that position. So I have a motion for that.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Discussion. Anybody questions? Roll call.
Kenya?
Yes.
Yes.
Spencer? Yes.
Marqueta?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, Brad, I'll go through with you. Resolution 2017-44, a resolution rescinding the petty cash fund of $100 in the police department.
Want to make that motion?
Second.
Discussion? Roll call?
Kenya?
Yes.
Dean?
Yes.
Spencer?
Yes.
Marqueta?
Yes.
Yes. 2017-45, a resolution establishing a new petty cash fund for the police department in the amount of $500.
Second.
Discussion? Any questions? Okay, roll call.
Kenya?
Yes.
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 Yes. 2017-46, resolution to transfer... So we need transfer balances. Wait, is there sufficient funds on these? Or what do we? What
is it? Basically, money or bills that came in 2017 that I charged back to 2016 line items that overextended those line items. Overall, in your budget, we had enough money to cover it, of course. But it's just moving the money around to make everything whole.
Okay, I'll make the motion that we for the resolution 2017-46.
So I'll second that motion. That's going to administrative and executive, fire hydrant service, public buildings, O&E, street lighting, and it's coming from streets and roads, SW,
$141,558. Thanks, Joe.
Discussion? Anybody have any questions, comments?
I have one quick comment. What does Aqua really do for $23,000? Flush them twice a year and paint them every other year?
There's an annual fee per fire hydrant. Our township has 166 fire hydrants that are considered public fire hydrants. Then there's this ungodly number, something like 0.134789 digits passed for what's called linear foot of water line in the ground they charge for part of the township. And then the customers use the water, they charge all of us. So if you want to get in money-making scheme, get into the water business.
No, yeah, apparently.
They don't charge us for repairs and stuff like that. So when the water's shooting out of the street, there's no additional charge.
Okay.
Roll call.
Yes.
Yes.
Dean?
Yes.
Yes. Last one, resolution 2017-47, resolution for the township to install and maintain two rectangular rapid flashing beacon pedestrian crossing signs on County Route 638 Greenwich Street for the Thomas Stewart Park. So that would basically be the pedestrian warnings that this county's requiring us to have installed there for the park. So I'll make the motion.
I'll second.
Discussion, comments, questions? Roll call.
Yes. Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Oh, the Haggerty bond.
Yeah.
Where's that at?
That's in the front of page 3. No. First page, number 9, tab 9.
Yeah, I wanted to bring this to your attention just because if you look at it goes back to 2006, it looks like. I guess what should have happened, since this was meant to be a bond, it should have went into our TD developer escrow account to hold that money there. It's not there. So I'm guessing at the time somebody just dumped it in to their own funds and it went into miscellaneous and now it's gone. So this $700 needs to be refunded to this gentleman, right, Paul?
That's correct.
So I just want to make you aware, I'm going to now have to charge a budget line item to do so, to get him his money back.
So we could hold his $700?
Well, I can shorten up some of this story, but yes. But he had discussed this with Mike Finelli many, many moons, years ago.
Yeah.
And Mike was going to look into it. Mike was well aware about the bond. And whether Mike got busy, forgot, don't know. But this gentleman approached me last year when I was originally appointed to the Land Use Board and presented that, which was the first conversation with Mike and Kathleen. And then Kathleen and I just recently revisited it. And we don't know where it is, but he's entitled to this.
So you need an action today? We'll just be paid through next month when we approve bills or what?
If you want to just need to run it through next month so that way you see it on the bills list or approve it tonight, I'll add it to this list.
Well, I think we approve it tonight.
Yeah, I mean, you guys wait
a long time. It's a long time.
Paul, you're making that motion or I'll make it?
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Discussion? I guess we had it ready.
You just got to figure out what line I had to pull it from. Yes.
Any money in Joe's account?
Yes.
Spencer?
Yes.
Marquetta?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Budget work session. Chief, I guess you can come up first and go. Or do you have something you want to start with, Kathleen? How do you want to do this?
I think from our previous meetings, we kind of ironed out your regular operating budget. Tonight, we wanted to focus on your capital budget. You currently put $100,000 in to down payment on improvements. That gives you up to $2 million worth of things to bond. Tonight, you need to decide what items those will be, how much you want to take it up to, pin it down.
Okay, so on a $2 million bond, or $1.9 million bond, what is our payment? I mean, I know you can't because you don't know have an interest rate, but what would be the principal?
Okay. We need to just put 5% down in this budget.
Right.
We won't know until we actually go out what kind of interest rate. And he's, the gentleman, who, by the way, is going to be here tonight, but is really, really sick. I forget if he said last time, was he looking at interest rates now, 4%, 5%?
He was here around there.
Yeah, I think it's right around the low fours, yeah.
So that, in this particular budget, you will just be putting a down payment on. Next budget, the 18 cycle, you'll actually see the, you'll have to pay an interest payment. If you do a bond anticipation note, if you do permanent financing, you'll have a principal payment and an interest payment. So I think John had said he thought the bands and the bonds were running at about the same interest rate. There's a lot of cost with bonds, they involve bond council, of course. So, I'd want to talk with them more about which one we should do.
So you're looking for a number of how much we want to bond? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
I thought we were going to have a capital...
Yeah, I was going to say, I don't know that we're...
No, we said we were going to have a capital projects meeting to go over the capital projects.
Yeah, that's what we said. We said nobody could meet, so we said we were going to do it tonight.
Yeah, this sounds like it's a long, this is a big topic.
Yeah.
Yes, it is.
I think it needs a
special meeting, right?
That's fine. I'm fine with that. I would like to see you introduce at your April meeting, because now we're getting it good into the year.
It's going to, you know, well, when are we supposed to get the bids back?
The bids haven't even got out yet.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
How are we going to give a bond number?
Yeah.
Well, we have estimates of the equipment.
All right, so what equipment do we have right now? All right, Chief, we got how many vehicles for you? Three?
Yeah.
Three vehicles.
But I also know that we were talking about buying that really nice mower that's probably out of the picture at this stage of the game.
There's a lot of things we were talking about.
Didn't we already kind of like say that we were going to wait at least until next year for that mower?
I still think it's in.
Yeah.
I forgot. Joe had mentioned that if we didn't order this year, you wouldn't get it in time.
Well, we were also discussing whether we were going to...
You brought up about if we didn't order the mower in time, you won't be able to get it by next year.
Yeah, it's not sitting around at the...
But we were also discussing whether we were going to sub it out. As Kathleen said, it would have been cheaper if we were buying the mower.
Right, yeah.
We were definitely going to sub it out this year, that's for sure.
Right.
But we didn't know what we were going to do next year, but...
You have a lot of options here. I mean, you could do a bond anticipation note just for a couple pieces of equipment, and then next year, if you want to get more into it, you can always roll that bond anticipation note into permanent financing and do more if you want to at that time. But we really need, and I know where you're going with this, Frank. It's like, can you get this all ironed out tonight? I don't know. That's a lot.
I don't think we can. I mean, I'm willing to meet on Saturday if we have to.
I said that last time when we talked about doing it. I said, how are you going to do it tonight?
That's a long meeting, I think, because that's a lot of equipment, it's a lot of money, and I don't know, you know, I know we were talking about the phase two of the park, too, and I know that...
Right.
Yeah.
And that's a whole other question. Do you want to include that in a bond, or do we want to do the pay-as-you-go and phase it out?
I don't know that we can, because we don't have the bids back. We don't have phase two bid it out. We don't really...
I think we did now.
March 25th too soon? That Saturday?
Not that.
April 1st.
The first Saturday? That's the following Saturday?
Whole day.
No, I'm working. I can't.
You can't do it?
Actually, I could if it's a morning.
Well, yeah, if we have it on Saturday the 1st, I'd want to be here at 8 in the morning.
Yeah,
I know Kathleen loves it.
Working all night there, mate. When's the meeting? Did we have our meeting on the 20th? Or the TC meeting is when?
The 20th.
Can we do the 8th?
That's Easter weekend.
Saturday.
That's Easter weekend in town.
Yeah, it's Easter weekend.
So I could do any day during the week that week, too. 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th?
In the morning, you mean, or in the evening?
Yeah, 16th
is Easter.
Okay.
So the 8th.
That's Tom. Okay, yeah. The 8th is okay with me, then.
What time is the Easter egg come? Is that noon?
It's 10 o'clock.
Boy, you going to the Easter egg hunt? Oh, it's right here.
Got a granddaughter now. She's 11 months old.
I know. I forgot.
Well, that's usually right around 11 o'clock, 10 o'clock?
I think so.
11 o'clock.
11. 11 o'clock? I mean, I'm an early riser. I could be here at 6 a.m. It's not a problem.
I'm okay with that, too.
11?
Starts at 11 a.m.
So why don't we look at the 8th? What time you want to meet?
April 8, 8 o'clock.
8 o'clock's good.
We're going to do it.
I'm meeting April 8, 8 o'clock.
Okay.
Put that in.
Do you want me to hold what I had there?
Yeah, I would say. Unless you want to do him, you going to be quick?
Yeah.
If he's going to be quick, you're just going to knock him out of the way.
I'd rather do him the best.
I did some of the operating, but I focused on the capital here to talk to you about.
Operating, I think we're okay with. It's just the cap.
Just one question on the operating. I see a secretary part-time and a secretary full-time, and it's two different figures here. Is that added on the bottom?
It's only one second. It's only one position. He wants to take it from
41.
So it'd go from that 26 to the 41. I think it's
yeah, full-time. But is that included in these numbers on the bottom?
Which page are you?
Page two. If you look at, you got a $21,000 or $26,000, and then a $41,600.
Oh, so you're saying are they combined already, and there's a $66,000 added, right?
So if you're, and then what under that it has?
$905,000.
Excuse me.
You have right underneath that $905,807.70.
Yes, and that would include what the new hires can keep in secretary part time. And then just under that.
Okay, I see it there. You broke it out.
Okay. I see. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
But as far as the last page four, I just revamped the capital that you were asking about. Explain further number two. I crossed out the new output test. I did receive information from the state that they did select a new output test. However, it is extremely unlikely that that is going to be available for purchase this year because of hearings that have to go on and have to be tested and whatnot. So crossing off the 26,000 there. Next that I crossed off down the list is the license plate reader I listed on there separate. That price is built into the one for one of the new vehicles. So I was just showing you how much I would cost if you took it off, took it totally out, how much that license plate reader is. Under that, number six, the tablets for the vehicles, again, kind of the same thing in a sense. Two tablets are built into the price for the new vehicles. So I wouldn't obviously need four tablets if we go with the new vehicles, because that price is put in there, so that would cut that about in half. So we'll go from 13,000 approximately down to about 6,600 if we get the new vehicles. The state terminal replacement computer, I had taken that off and built that into the operating, but that's not, I don't think that's going to be considered under a capital purchase. And that was pretty much it as far as what I was showing these cuts. The other stuff I feel is absolutely essential. Because we've been so many years it's not upgrading and replacing things. And
it's one thing I know I discussed with you, but I want the benefit of the rest of the folks up here. The three vehicles. We never buy that many 1 year for the police department, but we know we've inherited a mess with that. We're going to do this year. We should be able to get back on to buying like one vehicle a year.
Yes.
We're not going to get hit with two or three in another year or two, right?
We've been too many years of buying no vehicles. That's why we're in the situation we're at right now.
And that was under the same administration that caused the problem in the first place. So
on the SUVs, all three have to be SUVs?
Well, I put SUVs because the SUVs are only a couple $1,000 more. And that's me going to the capital as opposed to a car and not going to capital.
Just on the capital.
I mean, it's
and the SUVs are certainly all weather terrain, you know, for
safer, I would think.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Chief, how old are your guns?
How old are the firearms?
Yeah.
The handguns, both are over 10 years old.
Okay.
So that's another thing I was talking to Kathleen about. I mean, they're over their manufacturing life that the internal parts have to be replaced.
Plus, probably can't get parts anymore for them.
Well, you might be able to, but it's going to cost just as much as if you trade these in and buy new guns, because the firearms are worth value in a trade itself.
Nah, 10 years is lifespan. I'd say they start to see some of the parts for you.
I don't know if they fall under cap.
I don't think they do. I spoke to John Mooney about that one day. He said that he doesn't think that's going to be looking under cap.
Okay.
And we'll get a definitive answer from him, but I did mention it to him one day, and he said he doesn't think that's going to be able to be a cap.
That's handguns, rifles, and shotguns, right?
Yes. Handguns and rifles, not shotguns. Shotguns are fine, and they're really used. A lot of dorms are actually phased in them out.
Right.
With having rifles, we would keep them though, because for one reason alone, the bear. The bear shot is specific for a shotgun, not for handguns or rifles. So.
All right. Anybody have anything else for the chief? Okay. Thanks, chief. So do we need a motion for April 8th for a budget meeting? And I'll make that motion for April 8th, Mayor, if you don't mind, at 8 a.m. Somebody have a second?
I'll second it.
Discussion? We had already. Roll call.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. Okay.
And Lydia, as a point too, these budget meetings, they are open to the public. You know, so it'd be nice because there's never anybody, you know, it keeps you well informed.
Maybe we're going to have coffee this time. But first,
maybe the break last time. I mean, personally, there's been some people who have critiqued it. Pass and stuff like that, and I said these meetings are open, come down here and please point where, you know, and share opinions, that's all, you know, so well, a little small.
Okay. Okay, I'll make a motion that we accept the police department monthly report for February.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
All right.
Historical Commission. What do we want to do with that, Ken? What's the...
The recognition for long-time service. Second member of the... They switched it from April to May because of the weather.
When is it? In the second... Huh?
Second Monday of May. It should be May 8th. I printed out the email from Greg Glasgow.
Yeah, I saw.
They definitely left the mayor because
they had to pay. Yeah, I won't be able to make that.
I think Greg said that they were going to do up certificates and have the mayor sign off on them. But I didn't know what
to do. What time do they want to do that? At 7 at night? What was it? Who was it?
Doris Haggard. And Doris Haggard.
All a long time.
Yes.
Are they getting them plaques, did you say?
They said they were
going to get some sort of certificate. Certificate? I know. We want to do plaques in the township? We're not. The only problem with starting it is, and every time we get into a recognizing someone, we'll be stuck buying plaques also. Mm-hmm. So I don't know what the certificate. They're giving a certificate from their commission.
They're typing that they're doing them up, Greg said, and then having the mayor sign off to present them.
You just
okay, that's fine. I'll be there too. I'll make sure I'm there. So
we just have
unfortunately, I can't be there.
I have a proclamation.
Yeah, long time service.
Yeah,
yeah. Well, you and the clerk come up with something.
Yeah, I'll talk to you about it. Come up with something. Okay.
And maybe just advertise that there might be more than one committee per...
I think I was doing advertising, but I did for the Board of Ed.
Board of Ed, yeah.
We're doing...
Majority of membership will be each other next month.
What time?
Okay. Next is the interlocal service agreement between Warren County and Greenwich Township for 911 telecommunications services. That is basically what allows Warren County to dispatch our police, fire, and rescue and emergency management. Was it every 10 years, Gerald?
I believe so.
So it's probably something that hasn't been addressed in 10 years, but all it is it in here?
Yes, and it's authorizing the mayor to sign off.
Yeah, authorizing us to...
Tab 7.
Well, anyway, that's all it is. That's our agreement to allow the county to do that.
Mm-hmm.
So I need authorization to sign the interlocal agreement.
Can I make that motion?
Second it.
Second it, Morgan.
Discussion? Roll call.
Kenya?
Yes.
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 Yes. And I'm done. Frank, you're up next.
All right. You stole my thunder on resolution 2017-47, but that's fine. really, that was the only thing about Thomas Stewart Park, other than the fact that we're waiting for bids to come in on phase two. So that's it on Thomas Stewart. This next thing on the tabling, we discussed this in executive, so... overgrowth on township property. So I asked Joe to join us on this. I don't know if everybody's aware of it, but where the park is located and where the homes are and the development next to it, particularly when the farm development, on that boundary there's a lot of overgrowth. It's been there. It looks kind of unsightly. It collects a lot of garbage. Had some complaints. Asked Mike to see what it would cost to have the contractor that's currently there to rip it up and pull it off. He got a quote of $5,000 to $6,000. I think $6,000 was for if we were going to haul it off site. I think we could bury it. I mean, it's all biodegradable stuff. So I think we could probably bury it on site, and I think so too. So maybe closer to the $5,000 if we want the current. If that's something we want to do, first of all, and if we want the current contractor to do it. I asked Joe to come in to see if the town's capable of doing it and what are the possibilities there. I'll let Joe, let us know. If the town did want to rip up the overgrowth on that property line, if that's something we wanted to do, is the town capable of doing it?
No, depending on the size of the trees. I took a look out there. A lot of flags and markers. I don't know what is the true property line, so I would need somebody to at least guide me where we're at, where the true property line is. And we're doing it. I can't go on private property
right, to
be doing their work.
No,
I'm
yep.
seeing a lot of garbage, and if you say that, I would walk the line there along. Looks like they took a lot of garbage. There's flower pots, plastic chip or lawn furniture,
yeah.
bags of garbage, like they threw them over the fence and put them there.
Yeah,
so
we
what I would want to know where the property line mm-hmm. is, and I would just draw an imaginary line where that is and cut it straight up. Well, it's their property. Just because their fences stops and their yard piece don't mean that that's their property line.
So, Joe, you're saying cut, but what about rip? Like, if would you be able to backhoe it out of there and bury it?
Drop.
Can't bury something.
What? Oh, you can't bury it. Okay.
You can chip it up. We can chip it up and make it just lay it there. It can be there as mulch stuff, but you can't bury it.
Okay.
So, and all we would be able to do is probably cut it off flush to the ground.
Okay.
Because you start getting bigger trees and stuff like that. I don't have a machine.
That's expensive.
And just an initial thought without looking at everything else like that. I don't know that you really would want to take too much of the underbrush and brush out of there, because that does create quite a useful natural barrier that you are potentially about to open up.
Well, I don't know if you looked there, but we have that berm now, which is quite large. And if you look from the property side of the owner, you really don't see the parking.
It's going to take that berm a long time to...
No, you don't, you could go there right now, go there and take a look. If you stand where the houses are, because it's a little bit lower than the park.
Right.
You cannot see over that berm. So they have a natural protection with the berm right now. But Joe, have you done that? Have you looked in that sight line?
I would want to see where the property line is. I went out there and looked. There are some large trees there, but I don't know where the true property line is. I see markings on there, but it doesn't tell me.
Plus, a lot of those residents have been dumping back there, too, for all these years.
Yeah.
And that's the only problem.
Yeah, up from somewhere, and just knowing our territory, our prevailing wind is from the west. So it blows from that way, this way.
Right.
Did it blow from our property that way?
So I, first of all, it's unsightly for the park itself. So my recommendation, what I'd like to do is, if it's on the township property, if Mike could give you that property line, I would like to authorize the road crew to take care of it and to rip it up and chip it. That's my recommendation. That's
that project could last indefinitely too,
yeah,
you know, for,
yeah,
right.
Use it fill in, because right now we're not getting in there for 3 weeks.
Right,
and
right.
And with the construction going on and mud and muck and stuff like that. But I could work through it.
Okay. That'd be great. Save us some money.
Like I said, I definitely want to know where the property line is so I can keep track of it.
Does this tax your labor for your workforce at all?
Well, if I use it and fill in,
right.
We'd do all right.
No, okay.
But I'm not telling you when, but, you know, with your workload as it is, do you know when you could get it done by?
It's going to be a while.
I'm going to work through the summer into the fall. It'd be a while. It'd be most of this year. Right now it's all mud and everything. I ain't getting in there with
right.
The amount of snow.
Sometime in the spring, though.
We got to get some grass growing there.
Late spring?
Leave it firm out late spring.
Okay, that's fine. So, if everybody's okay with that, I'd like to authorize Joe to move ahead with that. Do we need anything? We need a motion?
Yeah.
I'm going to make a motion to authorize Joe to go ahead and clean up the township property along the Wyndham Farm property line, and then have Mike work with Joe to show you where that designation is.
Is that,
Wait a second. Would we at this point, though, add...
I'll make the second. I'll second the motion. So we can now have a discussion.
Okay. Sorry, yeah.
My question is, with that being the township property, what's his name for the
community?
Yeah.
You could probably put a garbage pickup stuff.
Right. Send them back there. That's one less thing.
Maybe Boy Scouts.
Well, I was going to say the Boy Scouts, maybe that 263, they might like doing something other than the road that they've been doing and stuff. But my question was, though, can we also make notification to all the homeowners who border this that, you know, okay, you got away with it this time, but it stops today? Would that be part of this, or would that be something different?
That
would add to it. No,
the reason part is to just do a letter saying, listen, we've had a problem with this in the past. You know, not accusing anybody, but just saying that we're going to be spending...
We're going to clean it up, and it stops here, right?
And, you know, please be careful. Yeah.
Okay.
Please be careful not to litter on the township property.
So just wanted to clear, you're gonna rip it up, you're gonna backhoe it out of there.
We're gonna be cutting it down, cutting
the flush
to the ground.
Yeah, backhoe.
We can rip out the smaller stuff, we'll be able to. Some of the bigger trees we're not gonna get, they're gonna be cut flush to the ground.
Okay.
And you want me to contact Bob Gretchenson about clean communities to
sure.
That?
Sure, and if he can't get to it, just let us know when he can get to it.
Okay.
Okay.
And if he can't, what I can do is we do have part-time help. I can schedule an extra and
great.
Go out and take care of
it. Awesome.
Okay. Roll call.
Kevin?
Yes.
Me?
Yes.
Spencer?
Yes.
Kevin?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, and lastly, the we talked about this in our last meeting, to increase the discount amount for senior citizens for their sewer rate. So this is the first reading for Ordinance 2017-02, the ordinance amending ordinance number 2012-20 and 2015-01, to increase the reduction in residential sewer user fees from 10% to 25% for income-qualified senior citizens and for eligible disabled persons.
Are you there as the motion?
So we need a motion on that? I need a motion, all right, I'll make the motion to introduce ordinance 2017-02.
I'll second. Discussion? Comments? Roll call?
Yes.
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 Yes. Hey, before we go on, I just realized April 8th, I can't make it. April 8th, I can't make it. You guys want to go without me for that budget meeting? I just realized.
No, you think you need to be there, so.
You're going to be in Easter Bunny, or what?
Yeah.
Get ready.
I have to get my,
uniform or costume.
I knew that date sounded familiar, I just.
How about that Thursday? Is that, that's to be the first Thursday?
I could do the Thursday night.
April 6th?
Six. Want to do Thursday night?
Will we open on first Thursday? Say anything in here?
First Thursday in the month?
The 6th?
Okay.
All right, so we just went to April 6th?
So we have to do a motion to cancel the first meeting, right? So I make a motion.
Just a motion to amend the, special meeting.
Okay.
From April 8th to April 6th at 7 p.m.
Kathleen, you like that better than me.
So that's the motion. I guess I made that motion?
Yep. I'll second it. Sorry about this.
Hey.
Like it everybody had.
Kenya?
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes.
I need a motion to approve the DPW monthly report.
I'll make that motion.
Second it.
Okay. Discussion? Roll call.
Kenya?
Yes.
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 Need a motion for the animal patrol monthly report for January, February, and up to the beginning of March. I'll make that motion.
Second. Nice to see that report. I like that report.
You should call that a lot.
Yeah.
Is it, would it tax her to jot times down to about how much time she did actually spend on it?
Really?
Well,
come on.
Well, hold on. I mean, is it a 5-minute phone call, or is it?
Well, she got called down a bunch of times. I mean, that's basically what it was right here.
No, I was just, I mean, I didn't think it'd be I'm not saying it's a necessary thing. I was just wondering if it would be, because it'd be curious to see what real time is, too.
I think it's overkill.
Let's put it this way. Well, this is the first time I'm seeing this.
Well, I guess this question is, like, I'll say 1/20/17, loose dog was staying in his place, owner was found, took the dog home. Did she respond? Did she find the owner? Did they call her, then call back 10 minutes later and say, never mind, the owner was found? Did the police find the owner? I think it leaves a lot of open-ended questions. Is that what you mean?
Yeah, kind of. I think the report was great. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I thought it was
certainly
a positive movement, but...
I'll ask her to revamp the report a little bit more, if she can be a little more detailed, just so that she can answer who went in the house.
I mean, all our employees here punch a clock.
This is her first contract.
Huh?
Venus is her first report.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
She had to start somewhere.
No, it was great. It was really good. I liked it.
I mean, on some of them it says upon arrival, so you know she went. Mm-hmm. And the other ones, you don't know what she did, so. That's all.
Some the county called her out, some the police department called her out, some I called her out.
Absolutely.
Okay. So what, you did make a motion for that report? Okay, that was our discussion. Anybody else have anything else? Roll call?
Kenya?
Yes.
Yes.
Spencer?
Yes.
Marqueta?
Yes.
Yes.
Fire department, member applications for blue light permits. Do a motion for that? For Troy Rush and Kristen Capelgo. I'll make that motion.
A second.
Troy is a renewal, I think I read.
Yeah,
he's a renewal.
Kristen's a new.
Like an ace renewal.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
maybe more. So maybe more than eight renewals for him.
What, a five-year permit?
What's that?
Five-year?
Three.
Or three.
Three or five, maybe.
Okay, that's fair, right?
Yeah.
It's probably not eight if it's five, come on.
You never know.
Forty years.
Yeah.
Lord of the Manor.
Yes. Yes.
Spencer?
Yes.
Marqueta?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, Bill, you're up.
Okay, I need a motion, or I'll make the motion to accept the tax collector monthly report, and it's under tab four, almost maybe five or six pages from the back. Is the total collection year to date of $4,616,602.02. That's for the general fund, and then the sewer is just over $89,000.
You made the motion?
I made the motion.
I'll second it. Discussion? Comments? Questions? Roll call.
Henya?
Yes.
Dean?
Yes.
Spencer?
Yes.
Marqueta?
Yes.
Yes.
Now, the tax collector appointment. Now, I've read all my notes online when you send it to me with the scanned copy, but I don't see it here. What tab is it?
Well, it's not written up yet, and I gave you like a revised copy. It's on there.
It's on here? All right, so then I'll turn it over to our attorney.
Yeah, the student provided me the information that said that the tax collector was appointed for a temporary term in 2014. I guess he had somebody previously who was retired, and then he had to be a professional manager. I guess he didn't hear working as not you, but prior condition. The problem is you can't appoint a temporary tax collector, you're appointing a tax collector. So when you have a position like that for a term, it's a 4-year term. So when the committee called her a temporary appointment or whatever they called her, when they appointed her as tax collector, she got a 4-year term. So my opinion is that she would not be up until December 31, 2018, and then if she was appointed in 2019, she would then have temporary. You know, she would have a full 4-year term and a temporary appointment. So there's no action that you have to take now. So
she's actually the full-blown.
Yeah, she's the tax collector.
Okay.
There's a number of cases on this, not just with tax collectors, but with other positions where people right. say, well, we're going to give you a 1-year term or whatever. If the statute says you get a 4-year term, unless it says you can make a temporary appointment, it's a 4-year term. So when the committee, again, it wasn't anybody on this committee, but when they thought they were appointing her as a temporary, whatever the language they use, they're actually appointing her as a tax collector. So the good news is she's provided good service, and you like what she's doing because you're going to reappoint her. So we don't have to, the committee doesn't have to worry about that until next year.
So we said a belated congratulatory letter.
And again, just remember that if she's reappointed in 19, that's when she would get tenure.
So. Okay.
That's just like when Kathleen was appointed, Kathleen, you were temporary. And then you guys took the motion.
Okay, so also came the Municipal and Charitable Conservancy Trust Fund Committee member. We need to appoint somebody to that. Where is that? I saw it online, but I didn't see it in the...
Go to tab 7.
Tab 7. Okay.
Second page down.
I did read it online. Second page in.
We got to go past the 911.
So, tab 7 is the second page.
No, that's towards the back.
It's probably towards the back.
Yeah, it's the
second
last
page is Warren County.
Yeah, it's the last four pages, or last, go back four pages from the end. So this position, it says here, the Warren County Municipal and Charitable Conservancy Trust Fund Committee is requesting that a representative from Region 2, which is Harmony, Lopat, and Greenwich, be appointed to serve on the committee. This 2-year term is rotated among the aforementioned municipalities. So, is anybody jumping on this committee?
Is this your, like, what is it, our year to pick somebody?
Yeah.
This is your?
And it runs from, like, March 26th to 17th and March 25th to 2019. The member's major responsibility is to review applications and make recommendations for finding of grants for farmland preservation, passive and active recreation land, open space preservation, and historic sites to the board of freeholders. So.
The last representative.
That was Elaine, wasn't it?
Elaine.
Yeah. She was on there for a number of years. I think she was ahead of it for a while. Yeah. So, seeing none.
Which meeting?
Does it have to be a member of this board?
Does it have to be a member of the Township Committee?
I don't think so.
It doesn't look like it. I'm reading it.
If you're a member of any board of directors or government body, then you're a director.
I think you'd be a great one for the rec or somewhere like that for the grants and funding and preservation, open space.
I think Bob Etchison might be even, maybe interested.
I was just going to say his name.
Because I was thinking Bob, too.
Might be something for him.
Well, he's under you, right, Will, with the, isn't he under your? Yeah, so would you reach out to him? Actually, it doesn't really start till late spring, even though it says March 26th.
Yeah, the meeting's not till June, right.
First Monday, June.
Yeah, I think, yeah.
Five meetings, so.
Right, it's really June through November.
Yeah.
So.
I'll give Mr. Etchison a call. And do you have his email address, Kim?
Yes.
Maybe we can forward his email to him.
And maybe, Kim, you can send him this email that you got to ask him if he's interested.
He's just about certified as paid for his course.
Yeah, he went to that class and all that, right? Yeah.
He'd be perfect for this one.
Okay, so we'll table that decision until the April meeting. And that's all I have. Okay, Paul, you're up.
I'd like to make a motion to accept the court's monthly report. This month stuck up on me. I didn't get a chance to ask them to change the fonts.
Yeah, really small.
But you can see that our fair share of that, again, was just a little over 5,000. It's in the middle of tab 4.
So, what was the total?
Are you making a motion or are you making a motion?
I made the motion.
I'll second.
Discussion? One thing I'd like to note, as I said earlier, I did meet with the mayor of Powhatan. He said he was reviewing some of the court records, and it looks like our revenues are rising as well as the activity in the court. So hopefully things are coming around with the police department, chief. So your numbers are up, right?
Absolutely. I wanted to actually, when you approve my monthly report, just give you some of the big numbers.
We didn't give
you.
No, it's up to Paul.
It's up to Paul. It's his time.
It's your time, Paul. Do you mind?
No, sure, absolutely. Go ahead, Chief.
Step up, Chief.
Some of the figures I just highlighted, I put it to our Facebook because there's some of the big increases. Ticket volume went up about a 40 summonses. And
Chief, pass that up to the audience. You know, I saw that on reading online, so.
Our arrests more than doubled. I've done a big push with getting our detective bureau back on track. There's numerous shoplifting that occur at our chase stores. This takes a lot of time to investigate, whether it's just a shoplifting or it's a credit card fraud. Last month, I believe we had two incidents of counterfeit currency. One incident involved the arrest of seven individuals at one time. The other one was two individuals that took their criminal activity over the toll hat, and luckily one of our officers was over there and able to stop them. A lot of these arrests are from follow-up work with our detective bureau, so very proud of that.
Okay. Thanks a lot, Chief. So anyway, the bottom line is the citations are up. It looks like revenues are getting better in that court, so.
Absolutely. I guess we'll never really realize, though, how much we could have if we'd have kept our court system here, but.
Well, with that, you know, you have a judge, you have...
No, I mean, I know there's other things, but I don't know that, you know, we'll ever really know that number. But that's fine. All right.
We roll call on that.
Yes. Henya?
Yes.
Dean?
Yes.
Yes.
Marquetta?
Yes.
Arson?
Yes.
And again, that was also done by the previous committee.
Right.
Give credit where credit is, if you want to consider that a credit, you know, so...
Also, I'm sorry, you must report. report, you'll notice that our call volume just about doubled from last February 2016.
16 to 17.
We're at roughly 500, and this February we're at close to 1,000.
Let me ask you, though, is that a real increase, or is it just poor record-keeping last year because you were down, didn't have a secretary the whole bit? So, I mean, is it...
A little bit of that, but a lot of... I would say a lot of that is admin tax. A lot of it is admin tax. But you'll see numbers such as... things like first aid calls went from 24 in February 2016 to 63 in February 2017. That's a pretty big increase in those calls. But I also did things such as I broke down some more categories like open requests. In February 2016, there wasn't a tally being done on admin tax, so it's hard to compare that.
Okay, thanks.
One other question, Chief, while you got the floor. The overtime, because of this new bail system, how much are, you know, what have you experienced since January 1st?
In January, we were at about 58 hours more of overtime than we were in 2016. A lot of that is...
So we added two guys to the force, okay, and we still have 58 hours more than January of last year.
And that's not only from these cases which are occurring more overtime, but also manpower is going to be, you know, back then we were running one-man crews. Now we're running two-man crews. There's also...
Well, January, you didn't realize the full benefit of your two new guys yet, did you? Were they alone
already? No, they were still on FTO. But also, in January, we had one officer out for the whole month for a return. So, really only increased one. And as you said before, back then you had an officer pretty much dedicated to the Secretary of Police. So, those little things are changing. In February, we were down 12 and a half hours from February 16th. And overall, in March, we're at about 28 and a half over.
Over last year's?
Over last year's at this point.
Are you keeping track?
A lot of that is specifically these cases that we're getting. It used to take us 3 hours to process someone. Now it's taking us 8 hours to process someone.
Right. And are you keeping a separate track? I would like to see a separate track, because that's the big thing that I'm reading out there, is that these towns are complaining. We've got a new state mandate, a new bail system, yet they don't support us from getting funded.
Amazingly, we're over at this point from January 1st till now, compared to last year's to this point, we're over 74 hours of overtime more. However, we're only $3,000 above, and a lot of that's because we have two new officers that are at a much lower rate than off patrolmen. So last year, from this same time period, from January 1st till, actually I'm going pay period, so January 1st till March 4th pay period, we were at 355 hours overtime. 2016, 2017, we were at $429, but like I said, the difference in pay is $3,000. In 2016, we expended roughly $21,000 in overtime during that period, and this year, during that period, we're only at $24,000. You know, that's a lot more overtime, and you could possibly be a lot more. It's not, but I can break down and give you the breakdown figures of exactly what overtime's going into: sick time, vacation time, call-out time for these arrests, call-out time for detectives. I do have all that broken down.
It's up to the committee.
If that's something you want to put in the monthly report, I could absolutely do it.
I'll talk to you about it. We'll see what we can do.
Thanks, Jim. Sorry, Paul.
No, that's all right. Okay, let's see. Zoning ordinance. Kim, I see it doesn't really have a number. Is this just because it's the first reading?
Yes. He just sent it to me today, right?
Yeah, the accessory building.
So it's the 17-3.
17-03. Right, I'd like to introduce this for first reading, and it basically, it's to provide a uniform setback in all residential zones. Over the last couple of months, we found it, and we just recently did something for Greenwich Chase, but the rest of the town seems to be a little inconsistent, so we're trying to make it all consistent at this particular point on residential, not commercial use properties with a 5-foot rear setback and a 5-foot side lot setback. So I'd like to introduce it. How much of this do you need me to read?
I think you just explained it, so...
We're good. I'd like to introduce this then.
I'll second that motion for ordinance 2017-03.
Discussion?
One thing. Was this reviewed by Land Use Board?
No, it goes here, then it goes there. They get a 30-day statutory review, and they need a comment, or they collect the time period passed, so...
Mm-hmm. But one thing, it really only changes the setback on the side.
On the side view.
Because the rear was 5 feet.
The rear was 5, the side was 12, now we're going to make it 5. And it's pretty much, it'll be uniform throughout the entire town now.
Roll call.
Kenya?
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Mike, this is where you're going to come in here with some legal advice. Bob Vetterson, myself, the Environmental Commission, and just in general, trucks causing and carrying litter, it's a zoning ordinance 3-10-7. I'd like to send out letters to our refuse companies and recycling companies, LMR, Premier, all of them, because on any given day, on those collection days, you can drive behind those trucks, whether it's windy or not, but windy it's certainly a worse day, and these vehicles are spewing plastic litter all over the place. I just want to send them letters, you know, not that they need to try to be a little bit more aware of the situation.
And I'll phrase it so that this is, we just want to let you know that this has been reported to be a problem, and that this is, you know, we just wanted to give you a heads up that this is something that we may be looking to enforce if there isn't some progress.
Exactly. Right. Okay. Let's see here. Truck traffic. Actually, no, I still want under litter yet. I want to go to the Warren Reporter. I'm going to single them out, but there are other issues. But the Warren Reporter does seem to have an exemption for a newspaper. On three different occasions, I've been monitoring when I came down here to the Township Committee meeting, and I wasn't able to do it today because of the weather. But just between, I can't live more than 3/4 of a mile away from here, and there's been between 18 and 24 of these reporters on the sidewalk, in the road, old, new, it's hard to tell, some of them drenched in plastic. And originally in the zoning book, it said that a commercial handbill under 310-1 and a non-commercial handbill and also AKA newspaper aren't allowed to be distributed like that. They have to be hand-delivered. However, later in the zoning book, it does say that a newspaper is allowed to be delivered so long as it doesn't end up in a public sidewalk, a public street, or a public drainage area. Again, this is something the Environmental Commission, Bob Vetterson, and you know, all of us, and I don't know if it's a real problem in some of the other communities.
Yeah, it is.
It is.
Yeah, that's all right.
All right. But obviously we can't tell the Warren Reporter we don't want their delivery because they have some exemptions. But how do we enforce?
Well, the thing, you know what, this has come up many times over the years, you know, since I've been doing this. And I know, you know, I probably have a memo I did 15 years ago, which I could just update. You know, a lot of it has to do with free speech because of the newspapers and stuff like that. So it makes it very difficult. But what I can do is just update, you know, a memo that I've done over the years that deals with what you can do and how you can regulate newspapers. My recollection is, and it hasn't come up in a while, I think if the homeowner notifies them that they do not want it delivered, but then you can stop it that way. You certainly can't as a blanket thing.
It's not really an issue of First Amendment there, I don't think, Mike. The issue is the delivery method. A guy drives on a road around 55 miles an hour and never hits its target. So they end up in the gutter, in the middle of the street, not in people's driveways. So,
and when
I don't think it's an issue of them giving it out, but it's just.
And when do litter laws? When does their right trump the litter laws?
Yeah, I don't. Again, I've done this, so all of this law is well settled. So what I can do is just say I can.
Aim better.
Update the memo and say this is what we can do and this is what we can't.
If you want to be a good community partner, they should be concerned about it.
I mean, can we?
Because I'm telling you, in my neighborhood, it's a mess.
Oh, no, there was street rotting in my neighbor's driveway.
I mean, can we force them? I mean, because they're going to window, it's going out both windows. Can we at least have them drive one side of the road to make sure that they're at least more accurate?
Now you're supposed to throw them out the window.
Yeah.
Oh wow! Oh wow! Really? See, I wouldn't have known that.
Just throwing obstacles from a moving vehicle.
Ah, okay. Well, they're flying, right?
Yeah.
So,
like I said, in the next couple of days, I can get you because the law hasn't changed that much on it. So it's been a while, so I can't remember exactly what we can do, but I will tell you exactly what we can do.
That's all of that we're looking for.
I don't get rid of that unless they have the shop lights right there.
Yeah, well, you know, if they hit the driveway, the guy certainly isn't getting invited to the NCAA, that's for sure.
Right.
He can't even hit the side of a barn.
And the next thing I want to see if we can, and again, this is primarily the residents on North and South Main Street, and although we do have an issue with Washington Street, which Mike Finelli will attest to, some road situation, and it occurs down on the southern end of town too, but we have a weight restriction on North and South Main Street is 10 tons. And I certainly know certain things are borderline, but the ones that are 20 and 24 tons that are rattling your house, a lot of us live 15 foot off the hair. And at 4:30 in the morning, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, your place rumbles. And with a 10-ton weight limit, it shouldn't be. I don't want the chief and the police department to be out there trying to... People are identifying these companies. Can we send them a letter as a town saying, such and such, this is not a thoroughfare to Route 78 unless you're making a local delivery. There's a designated truck route. There is a weight restriction on this road. And just make them aware of it and that the potential for enforcement is there. And I can eventually, I don't have it today because everybody's kind of compiling it, but there's a list of about 15 repeat offenders, and unfortunately they are all local businesses. The one that comes out every once in a while, you don't know. Somebody makes the errand turn, GPSs are taking them through here once in a while, but that's not really the big issue, it's the repetitive group.
Do you have any issue with engine braking at all?
No, okay. That doesn't seem to be an issue on my end. Bob Vetterson has talked to me about it, but it's that's a Route 173 problem.
I've seen towns where they have signs.
Right, absolutely. But they're also, and I don't know what we can do about Route 78. Bob's got a big complaint about Route 78 and the Jake braking going on there. And I'm thinking to myself, that's a challenge. I wouldn't even begin to know what to how to regulate that. But no, Jake braking doesn't seem to be a real problem.
Okay.
It's just the rumbling, the windows and...
Farm use is excluded.
No, farm use is excluded. However, that's during farm period of time.
Okay.
And I'm not going to single them out, but there are farm use trucks that are coming through here that are they're wholesales. They're hauling product out and hauling product in that have nothing related to farming in our community. I don't know that that's in the same category. If you're going out to Lancaster and Fort North, and coming back with product and using this as a daily truck, that's a trucking company. I don't know that that's farming.
And there's two different versions to that, too, because I looked into that, where they're hauling their product out to Lancaster. And with farm use, you're not supposed to haul anything back but your own product.
But again, friendly letters. Not jamming anybody up saying, hey, there is a designated truck route, Route 57, Edison Road, Strikers Road. These are all roads that don't have weight limits on them.
No, the Strikers Road does. Not on our end.
Not on our in all the Strikers. That's industrial from 57 down.
No, I was
that's the truck cutoff. Or, the jug handles up on Route 22. Just friendly letters. Again, just helping a couple of people out.
Yeah, a lot of letters, didn't we?
The what?
You got a lot of letters.
And then, this is going to address something that Frank had us look into. The site plans for the Home Depot, they don't designate snow. Now, we can add a amendment to their site plans, but at this stage of the game, it might be just best to send the contractors a letter suggesting that we would prefer it to be a less visible spot. A national service provider is the one that, each store up in all of these places are hire their own, but they got one service provider, and that's how one contractor got there. We can legislate where we want them by amending the site plan, or we can just maybe say to this particular contractor, hey, we think this backs piece right here is better than out here in the front.
That's fine. We could try it that way first.
Right. Okay.
Yeah, we could see how that works. I mean, it's not gonna, we shouldn't have to worry until next year anyway.
Well, right. And I'll provide Mike with the information, about the trailer that kind of might stay there after April 15th and, cleaned up and stuff like that, so.
Yeah, one other thing. I don't know if anybody else noticed this, at the Home Depot, between the Home Depot and where Bella Mia's, that little mall is, there's a parking area. There's a lot of rental trucks there.
You can rent through
Home Depot.
Through Home
Depot. But that doesn't sound like. I mean, that's something that they're allowed to do.
No, I don't think so.
There's a lot of them there.
Yeah, there can be. There can't be. Yeah.
Once again, maybe that's something we could put in there. Maybe that could go behind. I don't know.
Right. Now we're exploring a couple of things.
Okay. So you're aware.
They're not using their footprints the way they were supposed to.
Right. Yeah.
I've talked to Dave Barrett on the subject matter pre and this and that. It's a challenging issue to figure out.
And I know where you're coming from. Like, we don't want to be bad neighbors. Like,
right.
We don't want to make a hardship to them.
Right.
But as part of our township, we want it to look clean. We want it to look nice.
As a town that we do have an overnight ordinance there or anything. Because you also have private contractors parking vehicles that they can't bring into Wyndham Farms and Greenwich Chase.
But to run a rental business now out of that parking lot doesn't seem right to me.
But Lois does the same thing.
No.
They have their truck out there.
Well, the Home Depot has a smaller truck.
I think it's one truck.
Now you're talking Ryder, which is half a dozen trucks.
That's what I'm saying.
There are some issues there. Yeah. I think that's going to be a slower answer, but something that's on everybody's radar.
All right, so you're
looking
at it. Okay.
Yeah. And that takes care of that for me.
Okay, thanks, Bill. Township engineer report, we're going to skip. He had a death in the family, so he's not going to make it. Rather go to executive session. I think we should jump over to old business, new business, and get that out of the way. So,
sure, that sounds good.
108 Washington Street, the estate of Mary Schmidt. Who has an update on that?
That's part of the... Bonnie had provided me with a list of, at the last meeting, we talked about tax liens that would help buy the township. So, to my surprise, we only have six of them. The estate of Mary Schmidt is one of them. Asbury Graphite Mills is another one.
Oh, that little corner piece on 173 and
which I understand from not from here, but that at some point they're going to donate it to somebody, and then I think there's some environmental issues there, if I'm not mistaken.
Is that the one that has a grass light?
Yeah.
Isn't that the one that the state was going to take over?
Yeah, it's the old one.
But they were going to take it over when they were taking down the dam or something like that.
Yeah, and then I think because of the issues. I don't know. I shouldn't comment. Yeah, so anyway, there's six properties on there. If we're going to foreclose on them, because I think with the estate of Mary Schmidt, the banks abandoned the property. We had written to the heir. They're not, nobody's responded. So if you're considering doing a foreclosure on those six properties, there's a couple of benefits to that. Number one is you get them back on the tax rolls, you get them off, you don't have to resist on collecting taxes anymore. And again, then you can do whatever we want to do with the Mary Schmidt property, whether it's knock it down, it's from the looks of the report that the consulting done some time ago, probably be the way to go. Normally, if we do a tax foreclosure, we try to get at least 15 properties because there's more volume there, but we don't have. Luckily for Greenwich, which I guess you sell, somebody else buys all the tax rates, so the town doesn't get stuck with a lot. So that's the good news. But it usually, the estimate we usually give on those is around $2,500 per property. That's title work, the filing of litigation, everything. It's usually less than that, but you always seem to get one property that's got title issues that they have to do a little bit more of.
Did any of those properties on New Village Road that I sent the emails about last week come up on any of that? I had gotten a complaint about some of those properties.
Yeah, Mary Schmidt is on there, that's,
So they're not in foreclosure, just...
If you don't mind, there's six property, read all six, what are they?
Sure, it's, State of Mary Schmidt, Vince's Car Cleaning Service, Inc.
Do you have addresses?
What's the mailing address there? This is, I got the lot block.
Vince's Car Cleaning is, what's out there now?
Spoiler, what spoiler?
Spoilers, but Vince had it first, and Vince has it.
How much was that? I think it was probably bid at one time.
$1,354.61. So what happens a lot of times, as soon as you file a complaint, then people come rolling in and pay it. Then you have, I don't know which one, this is National Loan Investors, Block. Oh, 100 Asbury Road? Okay. Remember the name, that's $2,600. Asbury Graphite Mills is 700 Route 173, that is $38,400. Then you have James and Joan Johnstone, which is Shackletown Road, Greenwich Township, and that is, what was that? That was $18,989.
I would not have thought anything on Shackletown Road was in Greenwich Township. Get out.
Down there, and we're bombing.
And you have to go down there as the road department and do anything?
No.
Okay.
It's got a Shackletown address, but it's probably use that road to get to that block.
Those people still in there?
Is that a for Pine Hollow down there?
Jones?
What's that?
The backside of Pine Hollow?
Yeah, it used to be a second railroad, you go across the bridge, you go back in there, then there was a second one, kids were doing bonfires and stuff in the middle of the wooden bridge and burn a hole in it.
Yeah.
So the railroad poured it down, that was our access.
I was working on it.
No, that was one.
Okay, and what else you got there, Mike, or is that it?
That's the last one, so the question is, if you foreclose on it, you get them, are you gonna be able to get rid of it? Like I said, there is a benefit, can you get them off, you don't have to reserve, what about your taxes, $75,000 in outstanding taxes, I don't know what, that is, maybe Kathleen could say that, but, with contaminated properties, I could tell you that if you foreclose on them, you don't take responsibility for cleaning up contamination as a municipality, so you can still sell it, the question is, okay.
Who's gonna buy it?
If you foreclose on it, who are you gonna get?
Right.
Yeah. So, like I said.
So can we foreclose on everything but that one?
Yeah.
Yeah. We gotta get the ball going.
Oh.
Is that even on the market, or is it just sitting there deteriorating?
That's been deteriorating for 12, 15 years.
Right. I thought maybe it was on the...
What's the Shackleton address?
Yeah, it's on the street, yeah.
Okay.
So, I mean, that would be a suggestion, is maybe you take a look at some of these and see if it's, which ones are worth and which ones aren't worth.
Right, right. Something that you can get a little bit of something back, right?
Yeah, like I said, the main benefit I see is when you have these tax foreclosures, is you get the property back performing again, because the key is you wanna get title to it and then sell it, you know, have a property auction, and also increases your reserve for uncollected taxes, because right now, you're not collecting that money, and then you've gotta put it in the budget, and you don't know what our reserve for uncollected taxes.
You know off the top of your head, something?
Yeah, 448, 500, something like that, that's what I am.
So that would be my suggestion.
$435,000?
Take a look if you're familiar with any of these properties, and it's like which ones you'd wanna do a foreclosure on, and, you know.
Is it cheaper if we do it all at once, or if we just say, tell you, don't start with which one?
Nah, he's saying $2,500 apiece, but...
It's cheaper if you do it all at once, because if you put it all in one complaint, what we do is we draft a complaint and foreclosure complaint, that process is very painstaking, so what we do is draft a complaint, then we send it to this company called State Capital, which is an abstract company. They review the complaint and say, okay, based upon this complaint, and the way you have it written, we will ensure the judgment that you get at the end. So now we know we go through all this process, we've got all, everybody is supposed to be named, and then it takes a while, only because, as you can imagine, the economy hasn't been great over the past 7 years or so, 10 years probably.
And so what happens is nobody gets pat on the back for speeding foreclosures through the process in Trenton, and, you know, they don't put any more people to work the foreclosure, right? Because again, they don't want to be able to give anybody, you know, to speed that process. So, you know, you're probably talking soonest if nobody opposes anything, 9 months. And then what happens is if somebody pays, which is a great thing, you put them in the foreclosure, and then all of a sudden they come in, they pay, and they redeem the lien, then you just, you know, remove them from the cap.
Okay.
But it's, like I said, just feel comfortable with whatever properties that we're going to put in there. And
so let's put that on the for next month. We got to start some stuff.
Well, and we should certainly have somebody review these properties to see what their next to nothing value is anyway to get them back on the tax roll.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So who's going to review?
Well, I think we should find somebody who's in the real estate business that knows
a little bit. Frankel
or right. I mean, you know, not to pay it, but just a rough, you know.
Right, the assessor can.
Well, what they're assessed at and what they're truly worth after sitting in whatever condition.
Well, she can do a comparison.
She can do a comparison. Okay.
So, Mike, or can one of you get that list over to Eloise?
Sure.
You know, and you know, then I'll talk to just give me.
Yeah.
I'll talk to Eloise about doing an evaluation on that. Okay, Mike. Verizon Wireless. What are we going to do this resolution? Is that what we're coming to the conclusion? We really don't have a choice, or what?
That was supposed to go before the land use.
Yeah, you have a choice. So I talked to at the last meeting. You asked me to speak to Jonathan Grill about that. Because the problem was that you had things come in. Said, well, we've already got permission to put these up right away. We just want to put these up. The problem is that there's pictures of these things. And they're like a box, almost like not a transformer, but right. A square box that looks to me like it's going to be a structure. And they originally, and not just here, but in other towns I represent, they came in and said, "Ooh, there's nodes up there. I'm thinking something the size of a baseball." So some of these are going to be pretty big, and they don't tell you how many they're going to put them up or where they're going to put them up. Or so the League of Municipalities have taken their position. Well, some of these things could go to the land use board because they might be structures. So I talked to John about it, and he had done one that I provided to you, that he suggested, was basically just as you grant the consent, provided they go to the land use board and get approval. And then it says that they have to show certain insurance requirements. There's some good stuff in there about, you know, they have the permission of the right-of-way. If for some reason the other utility vacates the right-of-way because you put them on the telephone poles, if theirs expires as well. So there's some decent stuff, but I don't know if you're in a position to do the next. I think you should take a look at it, and maybe it's something that we send to Verizon to say this is something we're contemplating.
So what about equal access to other companies?
Well, I think another company, I guess, could go, because somebody...
I mean, this, how many we got now? We got Sprint, T-Mobile, Verizon, you name it, right? Well, they could all come here and ask for the same thing, right?
Well, yeah, the BPU is the one that has made them, the Board of Public Utilities, and said you have to go to the town and get permission and consent to put it on the right of way. So remember that whoever they're getting the permission from, and I don't know whether it's, you know, Sprint or United Telephone, whoever put those poles up, they've got permission from the person that owns those poles and put those up there. They're really asking us, because it's our right of way, you know, it's whoever's private property, but we have the right of way throughout the town. They're asking, do you have a problem with us putting this in the right of way? So I don't think that's the competition's necessarily an issue. I think it's more because the BPU regulates that. So they just said, look, you're not going to put anything up in the right of way without getting the permission from the town. So you can get it from the person that has the right of way.
So my question is this. Even if the land use board grants them the ability to do this, to give them access, can we be sued by another? Let's say they get the utility to allow it, T-Mobile, and they go to the land use board. Can the land use board turn them down? I mean, to me, it looks like a lawsuit to me.
Well, yeah, what? Anybody can sue you at any time for anything. I don't think that's necessarily...
But I think they have a case,
They have to go to the BPU first, though, because the BPU has already blessed this.
Right, so the BPU blessed that one now. But we don't want it. We don't want
to
have...
Well, if it comes in, they got to go to whoever owns the telephone poles first. And if they say, no, we're not going to allow you to do it. Now, if the person that owns the telephone poles and has the ability to use that right away says, yeah, we'll let you on there, too.
Are they getting paid? The person owns the telephone book? Are they getting any money?
Right.
Yeah, sure.
Right, so
They, I could see them saying, yeah, sure, the more the merrier.
Yeah, and I can tell you this, there's a vast difference between like cable franchise agreements and what you can extract from cable companies versus telecommunications. So telecommunications, basically, the only thing you can extract from them is if you have to put a notice in the paper, you can give them the pay for the cost of the notice. So just so you know, because cable, you can get them to run cable to schools, to the municipal building for free. So you have to do a lot of stuff because the statute permits you to do that. Telecom is different. So in answer to your question, I think that's more a BPU problem, and that's the person that has the pulse because if Sprint comes in or some other competitor, and the person that owns the telephone pole says, no, I'm not going to let you do it.
Yeah, my concern is they say yes because they're going to make money. So now we could have four different nodes on one pole.
Well, they could. I mean, the consent is...
I mean, personally, I'd like to send it right to the land use board and get them to give an opinion on it. That's...
They're using pre-existing poles, right?
Correct. Yeah, they went to whoever has those poles, and they said they give them permission to put their equipment on it. Now, right. Probably, I'm sure they're getting money for it. And then...
I just envision, you know, first of all, how they weren't that high off the ground either, right?
It's tough for me to say, but it was much bigger than I had anticipated. I mean, just from the pictures that I saw, you know, you're looking at a box that's maybe this wide that, you know, looked to me like it was 4 feet tall, could be 6 feet tall. I don't know, but and supposedly there's fans in there to cool them off when it's hot, and so there's noise. I don't want to overblow it, but there's just...
So it's known that they were like 10, 15 feet above the telephone pole, too.
Well,
that's all there were, huh?
Pictures I saw that were provided.
They didn't look too high.
They fixed the telephone pole almost like a transformer, for lack of a better term.
Right.
And then there's an actual antenna that's just...
Yeah, the antenna's higher.
And how high that is above the pole, I don't know.
But I think it should go to land use board.
Yeah, that's my recommendation. Send to land use board.
It's going to look horrible if you get three or four companies on it.
Oh, my God. Like I said, there's all... Ken, you know, we have people complaining about magnetic waves.
Oh, yeah.
You have fans making noise. You could have, I mean, it could be unsightly, too.
Yeah, if you want to live next to it.
So, I mean, my opinion is I wouldn't allow anybody.
Right.
But if the town committee wants to get an opinion on the land use board, I'm okay with that.
I'd like to see something where...
Because I just see, if we allow it for one, we're opening up the door for all the other ones.
And it should be restricted. Get it out of residential areas.
That too.
In a commercial area, I wouldn't mind it, but... Right. I do have a pole in front of my house.
Yeah, you wouldn't want that. But I think they did designate the areas that they were looking at.
She said they need 5 spots in this town.
Were any of them residential? Was it covered call?
I don't recall.
They didn't say exactly where they were.
Yeah,
I thought they did.
Yeah, I don't think they did.
No. I think they drive around and they get a signal or whatever.
What was the other piece you had to
ask? So you want to make the land use board could end up making that a condition that...
Well, my recommendation would be to disallow it, but if you want to send it to the land use board, you can make that motion.
Mike's got something else.
I guess the choices are not going to grant consent. Which, then I think it goes to the BPU, and then the BPU obviously has some overriding thing that makes it a lot maybe dumb. Or the way the resolution is phrased that John Drill provided is basically you're giving consent for the land subject to conditions. Mm-hmm. So,
well, and they can make the conditions, and that way we control at least the project, right?
I'd rather land use board take it and make the conditions now, like not wait for them to come. I'd rather them come up with some rules around this. Well, I would rather deny, to be honest with you.
Right, it's going
to
be more down the road because
I would rather deny.
There's more of that Wi-Fi stuff being used, and they're running out of
bandwidth. The rural community, I think, you know.
And the land use probably should address what's.
Yeah. So, what are we doing here? Is this
sort of making a motion?
If there's support for denial, I'll make a motion.
Well, this resolution sends it to the land use board.
Yes.
It doesn't send to the land use board. If it's telling them if they want to come to us to go to the land use board first. What I'm saying is...
You want the land use board
to come up with rules before they go to them.
Yeah, I can get on board with that.
Okay. Someone make a motion?
So we're not going to approve this resolution, right?
Before you, Mike's going to send a letter to the land use board asking them to come up with...
Yeah. Rules around the situation. You know, we'll address it. Paul's... No, well...
I just want to make sure we know what the resolution... I mean, what the motion is.
Are you on the board?
No, but me and Bob can fill in on it, but...
Okay. You know, I can just send it right to John.
I do.
Send it to John, yeah, he'll know.
Yeah, we
need
to talk.
Yeah, John will explain.
You want to make that motion?
I'll make a motion to ask the land use board to come up with the rules around...
Oh my God.
What do we call this?
consent, good, the township granting consent for them to put...
Put up these nodes.
Nodes in the...
Yeah. As stated.
Anybody want a second?
I'll second it.
A second? Discussion, which we had. Roll call.
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. The next, firehouse. Is that just a simple request for waiver of application fees for land use board and vehicle?
At the last meeting, we discussed, because we don't have an ordinance, because we can't do it by resolution, we really have to, we have to have an ordinance in place. So I spoke to John Kinkle about this as well. Now, municipal land use law permits you to waive fees for nonprofit, you know, fire department, stuff like that. John's suggestion was, and this may be something you want to discuss at the land use board, because I think we have a little pond full of buildings, right? I mean, you gotta close on the property first, so, I mean, I don't want to delay it, but I think it's something, because John said, look, I don't have a problem with an ordinance that waives the application fees, but, you know, the escrow has to be paid. Now, the escrows are where most of the money's spent. So, if you waive the escrows, then that means the township is agreeing to basically pay the professionals to do the reviews of the application. So I think it might be something, you know, the representatives of the land use board talked to John, because John and I were talking about this, and I said, well, the statute permits you to waive all fees under the municipal land use law, so that includes escrows. I think there's got to be a discussion about whether you want to do that, because the application fee is one thing, so it's, you know, a couple hundred dollars depending on what they're doing, but the escrows, you know, you're talking about the engineer's review and anything else that goes on, the attorney's work and all that stuff, you know.
Make it easier to give it to them in their budget, is what you're saying.
Yes.
Well, because in the ordinance, too, you have to be have strict requirements as to who qualifies. So 501c3 and 501c4, that's easy enough. But then, you know, how much do you make it? Like, everybody? Is it,
right.
You know, and then it can be done. It's relatively straightforward, but I think it's really a policy decision for the committee to think about. Because then... You can't just do it for the fire department. You're going to have to do it for similarly situated nonprofits. Mm. And then you could do it at your discretion, but then it just always puts you in a bad spot.
True. Why don't we discuss this during the next budget meeting?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. Okay. That might be the easiest.
Okay.
People is?
Yeah. People, the P-cards for the police department.
So I reached out to PNC Bank to see if that was a service they provide. They do. On their end, they're saying their minimum is $16,500. I don't want that. I don't think in a town this size you need that. I did talk about it with Chief before the meeting. I feel if we proceed with this that we should make our own restriction one, and I would prefer it in writing. That way it's clear for any future committees. I think nothing more than $1,000 per purchase would be appropriate. And then PNC is also indicating that you have to order a minimum of 10 cards. I would like one card just for the chief to have and for him to use it as he sees fit and approves for his department. Those are my thoughts.
Well, who do we get it from then if we don't get it from PNC? Who does the $1,000 ones? And who would give us only one card?
I don't know. I mean, I can reach out to other banks to see if they have other minimums, but I highly doubt anybody's going to go that low.
Yeah. Well, I mean, we could. Are they charging you per card kind of thing too, or that's why they're saying there's a 10 minimum? Or?
Yeah.
I was going to say just give them the chief to lock up, but
how much have you said you want to limit the card to? How much money?
It should be no more than $1,000 per transaction, and if there is something, it should have approval by the mayor and the liaison of that department. Because things do crop up, I understand that. But $1,000, anything over $1,000, now you're hitting your fixed assets. So I think there needs to be some controls.
Okay. So what do other towns our size do? You know, for their police departments. You know, in corporate world, we get an American Express card.
This is my first stab at this, uh-huh. But none of my towns do it.
Is anybody doing it? You know, Rich?
Actually, Yardley has been used, actually brought me on.
Oh, okay.
But I know that Department of Community Affairs definitely recommends them. And I don't know if you know, the reason why I'm asking for it is to purchase certain things that we need a credit card to buy online, especially for pricing things. Like, I can get things a lot better online with a certain place than I can other places. Or there's certain things that I, for instance, some of the maintenance parts for our firearms. We buy from a company, but they won't like take credit cards. We don't have a credit card. So we're kind of stuck with not getting the parts. And the other big thing is getting our email changed. The company needs a credit card. We can't do it any other way. Try to go around it every other way.
Don has a silly question. The town couldn't just open up an account with a regular credit card company?
No, that's not allowed.
Okay.
Bureaucracy at its time.
Well, there's been so many instances of abuse of it.
No, I understood, right. But it basically be in the chief's hand, right.
I guess you can't get municipal credit.
Well,
that worked as corporate credit card.
Yeah. Municipalities and government works more on an encumbering system and things like that, so it's very difficult to get people cards.
That problem, it's basically the same thing, even though the state doesn't really say that. It's just, you know, with PNC's controls of it, it's not necessarily how we want to control it.
So their limit is 16,500.
Minimum.
Minimum, okay.
Yeah, so basically they're saying, oh, and they want to issue, buy something for 15,000. I'm saying, no.
If you don't hit that number, what happens? Is it a surcharge? Or?
Oh, yeah, but...
No, there's no surcharge for that, but we can still get a P-card, and just with understanding that he can only charge up to $1,000 without coming here.
That's what I'm saying.
The other 9 cards, when we get them, just rip them up.
Exactly.
We have 1 card.
Exactly.
So but then you say we were paying per card, though.
You sure it's limited to $1,000, too.
No, that's our rule.
That's our rule. We'll get the 16.5 through the bank, okay? We'll get the 10 cards. We'll rip up the 9 cards and keep the 1 card.
Are they going to charge us a monthly access, a fee for those cards, though?
Well, that's what I'm thinking, PNC fees. Right, if there's a fee for that, you got to...
There's got to be some kind of, I don't know if they basically, take it off of our interest on our other accounts. I'm not sure.
It's got to be $35.
You know what would be an answer to this issue? Would be legal is a debit card, put $1,000 in an account, then you know the guy can't go over
$1,000. Again, the state...
Like, well, I know.
Blow it up.
All right.
We're trying to save money by finding these things online, to get something cheaper, but get our hands at that. So, can you check on the fees to see if there's any fees involved with that?
Okay. New business. Anybody have any? I just have a quick question. On the email I sent out, Joe, thanks for going up and checking my things on New Village Road. Did we get an answer from Bonnie on the taxes? Are they all up to date current on those addresses up there? Or? Do we have a process for the banks then? No one will be sending them a letter or didn't, right? So maybe let's see what we got and see if Mike can follow up on it.
With Tina?
Huh?
Cleanups or?
Yeah.
You're talking New Village?
Yeah.
Yeah,
I think in the house. Is that the one with the basketball court?
Yes.
I see. So. Okay, well, let's see what we can do.
Under new business, let's put the municipal garage. So we always have that. We get an update each month. Joe, where do we stand on the building?
That's got to be in the capital budget to have the money in there to put it out to bid.
Okay, so we have plans? Do we have drawings? Do we have color schemes?
It's pre-engineered design through them. Right now, all I got was made a layout just for a budgetary figure. That there will come in probably once you put it out to bid, put it out, we're going to have to probably have the spec sheet together.
Okay. Okay, so other thing for the 6.
Good. Anybody else? Okay, motion to open public comment period again?
Second.
Favor?
Aye.
Aye. Same rules as last time. Anybody wishing to come up to the podium, state your name, address, make your comments? Anybody? Excuse me?
Whatever.
No, you could address anything.
Okay.
I want to pick up where Mr. King left off in terms of the court. and his statement, I believe, was, "I'll never know what the revenue is, if we're saving or not, with the shared municipal agreement with COHAT." Did anybody ever do a feasibility study? I realize it's just the prior administration, but my comment is, my question comment is, was there a feasibility study done? Why not?
No, there wasn't.
There was some sort of report that the previous auditor did was 16. And does anybody know here?
I may have been out of line when I said that too. It's just kind of a pet peeve.
I think it was a good point, and that's why I'm here talking about it. And also, the shared agreement between the two municipalities. Does anybody here know what it is?
Yeah, we do. I don't have it in front of me. There's lots of information available to it.
I'll help with that too.
I don't need. Yeah.
Shared services court agreement. It's up next year. I know that. I wanted to myself, the auditor, maybe somebody from the committee, we can start going over that and how we can restructure it to maybe make it more beneficial for Greenwich.
Right. And next Monday, the court, the state court administrator is going to be meeting with POHATCON with us too, and I was going to try to be over there to attend that. I mean, things this year actually kind of did free up dollar and cents wise, because we're not, because we're no longer paying for a judge that we used to pay for. No, right.
Well, I'm going to over all of this because from what I've just heard, the revenue's down $45,000. That has to be ticketing. A few years ago when we had our court, the revenue, I'm going to compare the revenue before when we had our court here and what the expenses were compared to what the revenue is now. And what our expenses are between the shared agreements between the two municipalities.
Okay, yeah, but see, the purpose of the public comment,
it's
not for us to have a dialogue with you, because it's just not fair to everyone in here to...
Well, I'm having a dialogue with myself, comment, and I'm also speaking to you and the public. They're hearing my comments.
Yeah, we have a three-minute limit, though, for that purpose. Okay.
The point is
we can't answer everyone's questions and bring them up to speed for the past 3 years every time they want to come to the meeting and ask a question. So.
I'm making comments.
Okay.
I just heard.
Okay, I misunderstood you then.
Mr. Dean, I'm not asking for a response, although I think my other question was, I'm going to be calling each one of you individually. And I
want
to see if you can respond to me personally, which I can do, correct?
You can call anybody you want. Yeah, I don't have to necessarily respond, but you can call.
That's my right as a taxpayer. Right?
Sure.
I can just call you personally.
Well, hold on, Frank. Let's go through public comment first. Yeah. And we can all say
anybody else have any comments?
State your question and then
this one's going to be real easy.
State your question.
State it, and then after public comment, we can probably answer it.
All right. Now that you've chosen to move the firehouse from behind this facility to this wonderful new place down the road, what are you guys going to do with that space now that we'll be empty?
State your comment.
That's my question. Actually, it's a question and a comment if you can actually read between
the lines. Yeah, we hear you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thanks. Anyone else?
Any motion to close public comment?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Anybody want to?
The first thing I want to say about the courts. Courts will never come back to this municipality unless we redesign this building, because it is not compliant with...
Currents.
What's the three letters for the
AOC standards?
AOC standards.
Cost you
first of all, I don't know any court that's making any money in the state of New Jersey, so if they're dead losers, I have towns that I represent that switch and go from this one to that one to try to, it's just no magic bullet. It's just what the AOC does to you, it makes you do. And if it's, you're usually trying to stem the bleeding. So.
Right.
So, but yeah, if you had to do it, you have to have a separate entrance for the judge to clean it up. You have to pull it through glass. You have to have this has to all have Kevlar in it, so it's bulletproof. You have
this used to
the
be
windows
the
aren't right.
And so long as it stayed a courtroom, it was grandfathered under all the rules. But once it moved, you basically need a new municipal building to satisfy a new courtroom. So it's not going to come back and. But
no, and you're right, and the AOC, I know one person in particular, I'm not going to mention the name of it, but they had ignored the AOC on some bulletproof because it was going to cost them $75,000. Now, this is a more modern court.
Mm-hmm.
And then when we went to re-up a shared court agreement, they said, we're not signing off on it, and you're not doing it until that glass goes. So, you know, they used the carrot and stick to make it comply. So it's all state regulations, and it's just...
When you communicate with us, you know, I can bring you up to speed on a lot of things. You're going to be a little bit surprised for a variety of things, but I'm looking forward to the conversation. And then, have we actually decided for Mr. Brunk our general thought process of what we were thinking about doing? Can we at least share the vision?
One of the discussions is... Well, there's several things that we're looking at. The Legion may be going up for sale, so that may throw some things into it. We need more space for the police department, obviously. So that space will probably be gobbled up rather quickly.
Right.
I think there's one other important point, though. We didn't decide to move the fire department. They decided that they want to move under one accord. Correct, Joe? So we didn't decide to move the fire department.
The fire department
is, yeah, they're standalone. That's their decision that they want to move out.
This has been...
Yeah, and I think it's a good decision, yeah.
18 years in the process.
Right. And the plan is the fire department's paying for it, so...
But yeah, we need a lot of space for the police department. They're probably still going to take most of that space. We still need some space for the DPW and the last bay. And again, this whole new thing is that the Legion may be up for sale, so we may be looking into or interested in possibly purchasing that or using it. So
there's a lot of useful space around here right now.
We need space. Yeah.
Storage.
Yeah, record storage. That's another issue.
Anyone else want to speak?
And you still have to figure out what to do with the old school.
Well, but the good news on that.
Well, we got that up.
We are out on the... Check our website. There's an RFQ out.
There is.
Yes.
Just went up this week. So there's a deadline. So hopefully in the next 30 to 45 days, we'll have some interested parties that want to present their plans to this committee, and we can wash our hands of that building.
Okay. We're back to
executive?
Yep.
Yes. So I'll make a motion to go into executive session.
Motion by Bill for executive second.
You want to read off the list of what we might be discussing or what we...
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
We have personal matter dealing with a rights notice, and then we have contract negotiations from the police.
Okay.
I don't think there's going to be any anticipated action either.
Right. Well, we're going to do... We have to do all in favor for... Bill made a motion. Will second. You got that? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Thanks. Thanks for coming, everyone.
Thanks, guys. Anybody need a...
Up here? Anybody out in the hallway?
No, it was just a rework and the chief, but he left. So...
Hopefully they ironed that out.
25 years ago, we fired somebody.
Make sure we take that so you lock it up.
Works, right?
Huh?
We got the email with this and all that.
Yes, yeah, yeah.
Chief talked
about it.
Okay, motion to come out of executive session?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? The attorney gives the explanation, please.
Yes, the emergency, our second executive session at 10:08 p.m., and we discussed a personnel matter dealing with rights notice of an employee, and then we discussed a contractual matter dealing with the Legion, and we discussed attorney-client privilege matter dealing with COA. No official action was taken. Copy of these minutes will be available at such time as the committee determines there is no harm to the public interest.
Thank you. Motion to adjourn?
Second.
Frank, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay, thanks. See you in 2 weeks. Good thing I remembered my, you know where I'm going, April 8th? Oh, I forgot, that's just all.
Yeah, go wherever.
Okay.